Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the University of Illinois System's 2022 Town Hall on State Issues. My name is Jennifer Creasy, and I am the System's Assistant Vice President of External and State Relations. It's been a year since we last hosted this event, and today we will be recapping our advocacy efforts over the last 12 months, as well as highlighting our priorities for legislative and executive actions this year. We will begin with a presentation from President Tim Killeen, followed by a question and answer period. Please feel free to put any questions you may have in the chat. I think we've all been well trained on how that works by now. And with that, it is my distinct privilege to introduce the 20th president of the University of Illinois System, Dr. Timothy Killeen. President Killeen took office in May of 2015 and has led a new wave of growth for the state's flagship university system. We will be hearing some updates on that shortly. He brings with him more than three decades of experience as a teacher, researcher, and administrator in public higher education. That somewhat intimidating resume includes working closely with all of our state and federal government officials. So please join me in welcoming President Killeen.
Thank you very much, Jennifer, and good morning, everybody. I hope you're all well, and some of you perhaps stayed up a little late last night watching a certain basketball game, but it's so wonderful to have you all paying attention to the University of Illinois system. I deeply appreciate your support, and I know that everybody here is a staunch advocate for who we are and what we do. You know, you turn on the news and you know, it can be dismaying sometimes when you see what's occurring elsewhere, but I can personally attest that at your university, there's goodness, there's brilliance, there's honor, there's commitment, there's support, and we're making great progress. So please do enter your questions in the chat, and I'll try to answer them as best I can. Always exciting to connect with alumni advocates and our other friends. You serve to not just me, but our whole community inside the university of the possibilities that an education can deliver, a good education, a world-class education from our three universities can deliver and better the world, one family at a time. I really hope that you and your families are safe and remain safe as we continue to work our way through the challenges of the pandemic. And I'm personally, I'm sure all of you too, looking forward to the day where without question we can gather naturally in person again. And hopefully that's very soon. At our last meeting in March last year, your help was extremely productive. And we appreciate your loyalty and your advocacy since then. You've had a real impact on a positive trend at the University of State Support. And it's the kind that we can now build on in 2022. And I'll talk about some of those opportunities, including our strong push for a state reinvestment in public higher education in just a few minutes. But first, I'd like to share with you a new advert that is now airing for the University of Illinois system. We're being more energized and active in projecting our message outbound. And I just wanted to share with you this new piece that we have.
Right now, you're in the middle of it. A complex system that is simply human. Three universities, a healthcare enterprise, communities and partnerships connecting to better the world around us. Together, access to education, healthcare, and innovation is expanded. Opportunity is shared, and our economy is strengthened. What you are witnessing is the University of Illinois system, because when we unite the best in each of us, we are all together extraordinary.
Hope that little clip just captures some of the momentum and excitement of the university that we have. And I'd like to cover some of the principal materials in this hour. So let me, and it gives me a tremendous charge to see what's going on, real feeling of momentum and upswing. So let me get into a few of the details. Let me start at the core of our mission, which is students. You know, unlike it's the economy, stupid, for us, it's the students, central, most important aspect. And put simply, right now, we have more of them than ever. historic high numbers of students. Our system-wide enrollment reached a record 94,750 last fall, and we have more applications than ever going into the next year. And that's in the middle of a global pandemic. Families and individuals voting with their feet to gain access to a world-class education. And if you think about 94,000 plus students, that's enough to fill Soldier Field and Chicago's United Center with another 10,000 students waiting to get in. So it's a large number of individuals that are at the University of Illinois system today. And of course, we have this huge alumni base as well. So the enrollment's on a steady upward planned trajectory. None of this has been thoughtless. We had a strategic enrollment plan that we've accomplished in the last 5 years, and we're refreshing it now for the next 5 years. Our enrollment has increased more than 13% over the last 5 years, and 22% over the past 10 years. And that means that we've added the equivalent of a mid-size university, a new university to Illinois' higher education landscape in the past decade. At a time where a lot of people are worried about out migration and loss of enrollment, we've added 16,000 in the last 6 or 7 years. So it's an entire new university of real opportunities for students from across our state. And just as important, our students are increasingly a reflection of who we are as in Illinoisans. Illinois is in our name, so we care deeply about our land-grant mission to this state. Here are just a few examples. Almost 60,000 of our undergraduates are from Illinois. More than half of all of the Illinois residents enrolled in public universities in the state. 4 out of every 5 of our undergraduates come from our state. Very few peer institutions can say that, whether it's Michigan, Purdue, Indiana, Missouri, none of them have the focus, the intense focus on students from our own state. Further, more than 26% of our students come from underrepresented racial and ethnic groups. And that's more than 25,000 students, an increase of over 70% over the past decade. So we're increasingly reflecting the actual diversity and makeup of the of Illinois and the United States. 1 out of every 5 of our students is the first in family to ever attend college. And they graduate and they pay down their debts if they have them, and they're retained and they come through successfully and participate in civil society. But that number, 1 in 5, is more than twice as high as our first generation enrollment just a decade ago. So we're moving in really important directions. We're also geographically reflective of our state. Between our 3 universities, we have students from 101 Illinois counties. Illinois only has 102 counties, so we're pretty much in every county. And these data points make me intensely proud, and I hope you share in that pride. Our growth and our ability to serve the state, all of it, is a product of our commitment in great part to accessibility and affordability and of excellence. Excellence that the students and their families expect to find once they've beaten a path to our campuses in Urbana-Champaign, Chicago, or Springfield. Our universities are ranked among the very best in the country. And the most recent set of rankings just a few weeks ago reflect our strength, particularly in online education, which is really important these days, as you appreciate. The U of I was the first ever to have online educational software in place, and the first to develop the user-friendly browser that enables, and the first university or the first institution anywhere to develop the chat room technologies that we're now using for this webinar. But according to the US World News and World Report, the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign is ranked in the top 10 nationwide for online master's programs in education and engineering. And the University of Illinois Chicago is ranked number 3 in the country in online bachelor's programs. The University of Illinois at Springfield's online bachelor programs were also in the top 10%, rising to number 29. So we know how to do online education with excellence. And yes, it's been a grueling couple of years, but I don't think our students can feel in any way disadvantaged materially with their access to a world-class education. And of course, we're back face-to-face completely now. We continue to keep this world-class education affordable by holding down costs. Tuition has been frozen at the University of Illinois system 6 of the last 8 years. So in all but 2 years since 2015, even as our costs have increased, as you might imagine, through inflation and other factors. And we're also committed to providing financial aid at levels that make a tangible difference in the lives of our students. We don't want any qualified, hardworking student to be, not able to gain access to an education of the quality that we provide. This year, the University of Illinois system is providing $261 million on its own, institutional financial aid. And that's $122 million more than we provided 10 years ago. So we've been growing our commitment to financial aid as we've been keeping our tuition down. And that's in addition to the $279 million in federal, state, and other outside aid available to our students this year. We're extremely grateful to all of our many donors. We've had a fundraising campaign, as you probably know, the last few years. We've now significantly exceeded the $3.1 billion goal a year ahead of time. And those dollars primarily or largely flow into financial aid for our student body. So we're committed to access, affordability, diversity, and absolute excellence in everything we do. U of I system, by the way, directed roughly $84 million of the federal relief that we received from COVID of $173 million. So more than half of the federal relief went directly to student aid during the pandemic. As a result of this robust commitment, about 30% of our resident undergraduates from the state of Illinois pay no tuition, and only a quarter pay the full price. Another major source of pride for our universities is that 2 years now into the pandemic, we can say that our students have remained for the most part on campus with a normal kind of collegiate experience. They have been safely attending classes and enjoying a rich, full college experience. Sports events, concerts, museum exhibits have continued on all 3 campuses. Many universities can't claim that. You might have seen, the enormous snowball fights on the main quad in Urbana early this month. If you haven't, I encourage you to Google it, or perhaps if you don't like snowball fights, don't Google it, but it was a big one. But I credit and really value and give a huge shout out to our students, faculty, and staff through the pandemic for taking common sense measures like mask wearing seriously and for being quick to get one of the available vaccines. Our vaccination rates have long been above 90%, above 95%. And so there's a feeling of safety on our campuses that enables our work to continue. Every bit as important as these steps has been the SHIELD saliva-based test and trace system. I hope you've heard about, initially developed in Urbana-Champaign in the opening months of the pandemic, a real-time example of why research-intensive universities are important to society, a real-time example of research and innovation conducted for the public good. I know last March we talked about SHIELD when we had one successful semester complete with very low infection rates on our campuses. I'm really proud that we've had no student severe illnesses or deaths in our student body. And since that time, since last March, the SHIELD protection has been widely, massively expanded, and it's saving lives, literally saving lives and protecting communities across Illinois and well beyond. Our SHIELD Illinois non-for-profit in the state has a strong partnership with Governor Pritzker and the Illinois Department of Public Health. And through that collaboration, SHIELD is now in use in more than 1,700 K-12 schools around the state. Our tests are also the first line of defense in 57 colleges and universities, including many famous universities, at 19 community testing sites, and at major corporations like ADM and the electric vehicle maker Rivian in Normal, as well as the state legislature and the state judiciary. SHIELD testing, in fact, is now available to 1 out of every 3 Illinois residents for free. And for months now, Shield Illinois conducts more COVID-19 tests on its own than the majority of United States, the states in our country. But Shield is now a national and even international success story. Shield T3, which is our outside of Illinois for-profit venture, which is part of the Discovery Partners Institute, is working to spread the use of affordable Shield testing, tracing, and tracking outside of Illinois. And it now protects students and staff in the District of Columbia Public Schools, in the Baltimore City Public Schools, as well as a large number of universities and private companies across the country. It's also providing the test internationally. The Philippines Red Cross, for example, now uses Shield. So from the early days of the pandemic, with the innovative capacity that we have and the commitment to helping people and to creating safety initially for our own campuses, then our communities, then the whole state, and then beyond, Shield has proven to be a real remarkable example of the power of the University of Illinois system, of the innovation that the brilliant minds that we have are capable of. And this is right out of our playbook. This is right out of our strategic framework. I talked about this in greater detail last year with this group, but as a reminder, we have a strategic framework and it's our guiding light for everything that we do. It was approved by the trustees in 2016, and it's organized into four simple pillars. And right there at the top is number one, an institution of and for our students. Also among these pillars is the responsibility to help provide a healthy future for Illinois in the Midwest. That's what we've been trying to do. And a major thrust of this pillar is economic, evolving our approach to economic development to meet the changing economy and demographics of the state while taking on a leadership role among Midwest institutions in reinvigorating the region's economy, making it the international magnet for investment and talent that it can become. And that's a bit of a mouthful, I know, but the strategic framework is kind of easy to remember. I've got it on my coffee cup here. There's the University of Illinois system on one side, and here are our four pillars on the other side, and they make a word: students impact Illinois today. So it's a easy, rememberable mnemonic, so we never really stray from our mission. I mentioned earlier the fundamental importance of our students and their experience. We're living up to that pillar in part through two important institutions that we have launched very successfully, and that is IIN and DPI. IIN stands for the Illinois Innovation Network, and DPI stands for the Discovery Partners Institute. These connected enterprises are both actively building the engine of a next generation economy that reaches across the state, providing opportunities for communities large and small. That means both the innovation that lies behind high quality jobs and the skilled, well-educated workforce they demand, a workforce that can be upskilled, it can be reskilled, and that is tech enabled to participate effectively in the modern economy. The chancellor, the three chancellors who lead our universities, and I saw this forward motion of this initiative for ourselves on a 2,000-mile, three-part state listening tour last fall. Just before Omicron came in, we were able to visit the state and see many of the 15 IIN hubs at every public university in the state, around the state, and other places as well, with their work focused on innovation, job creation, on the local strengths and needs, but connected through the University of Illinois system to an advanced cyber infrastructure and capability. As examples of this are everywhere, in Peoria, Rockford, Carbondale, but as an example in Urbana, the new Illini Hall, soon to be built there, funded by the DPI IIN funding, with $500 million of state appropriation matched by another $500 million of institutional and philanthropic support. In Urbana, the new Illini Hall will be a data science center, unbelievably capable data science center that will be a brain or a nerve center for the whole state of Illinois as it moves further into this century. And DPI's headquarters on the Chicago River in downtown on land that's been donated to the university is now under final design. And it's going to be an iconic facility and building in Chicago, but the work of DPI is already well underway. And there are many examples I could give, but just one example, DPI is partnering with Urbana-Champaign on a program to train K through 12 computer science teachers. We don't have enough of them, and we need them to make sure our students, as they come through K through 12, leave primary school with the kinds of skills that they can imagine a career path that would lead to jobs in a technology-based economy. There are many more tech-enabled jobs than we have capacity for, and we need to serve that role too. So DPI is taking a leadership role. Research that drives the innovation behind so many of these jobs that are now being created will be driven in large part by the University of Illinois system. And this research can, as we saw with SHIELD, can deliver solutions to society's urgent problems better than almost anything else. SHIELD is a direct product of brilliant research conducted by University of Illinois faculty and the applied research. Our total portfolio of research from federal agencies and other agencies is $1.2 billion per year. If you think about that, all of those dollars are flowing into Illinois' economy and creating the kind of new knowledge base that is going to be so important for many, many issues: advanced manufacturing, cybersecurity, healthcare delivery, vaccine developments, and beyond. To give you an example of the kind of importance of this research to the populace, our Prairie Research Institute is leading a large-scale pilot testing of carbon capture technology, driven by a major grant from the Department of Energy at a power plant in Springfield. And this kind of work will really change the ability to avoid deleterious environmental impacts as we go forward in the future decades. UIC, University of Illinois in Chicago, has had an absolutely incredible year of research growth, sponsored research at an all-time high, more than $450 million, almost half a billion dollars of research at UIC. Obviously, its strong capabilities in healthcare delivery have been really important, but it's an all-time high for UIC. And it includes things like $4.2 million from NIH to study the safety and effectiveness of blood thinners to treat adults diagnosed with COVID-19. And UIC researchers are looking at long COVID and what that means. And of course, we did the pioneering vaccine clinical trials early on that led the United States and Illinois to be as well prepared as they are today. And at UIS in Springfield, we more than doubled our federally sponsored research over the last year. So these are all kind of success stories: enrollment growth, affordability gains, diversity gains, research gains, and clear examples of the importance and the value proposition of public higher education for the state. So I hope just with this little flavor of things, you can appreciate why I'm so energized by what's happening across the University of Illinois system. And the future is very bright as we continue. What we need, of course, is robust, appropriate state support. We're grounded in the state. As I said, 4 out of every 5 of our undergraduates comes from the state. It's amazing what we can deliver back to the state. But we need that funding, we need that partnership, we need that investment, and everything you represent and bring to the table is incredibly important to make sure that people recognize and the decision makers recognize that, that support. Now our state is in a position to begin to reinvest seriously in public higher education, and not just us, but all the other public universities as well. And we're delighted to say that Governor Pritzker's recently proposed budget would begin to do that in a serious way, reversing what has been 20 years of erosion in the funding base. In fact, it's 40% reduction in funding for us over the last 20 years. We're now reversing that, and huge benefits will flow from that. The governor's budget proposal, which was announced earlier this month, includes a major increase in operating funds for the U of I system, $56 million over the next 2 years. And the governor also recommended, and we're very excited about this, $122 million increase for the state's monetary award program, which provides financial aid to Illinois students, including thousands of our own students across the University of Illinois system. If the budget is approved, the additional operating funds would also allow us to put an extra $10 million a year in undergraduate scholarships for students from Illinois so that we can slow the flow of those who now choose to leave the state for college. Another $7.5 million of our budget request would expand bridge programs to reduce barriers for enrollment for many students, to allow for the onboarding to just enable successful retention and progress through the academic studies. Another emphasis area in our budget request is on mental health programs. As you all know, it's been a grueling couple of years with the isolation and difficulties of socialization, particularly hard on young people who are genetically wired to make new friends. So we are requesting an extra $7.5 million from the state to help meet the needs of our students, to provide the kind of resources and support for good mental health as we move forward. The system also plans to devote $10 million to recruiting more world-class faculty to meet demand created by our growing enrollment. As we've added these many thousands of students, we need now to go into a faculty recruitment mode. And I'm estimating that we're talking about perhaps even as many as 900 recruitments in the next 5 to 8 years. And if we get the right kind of diverse, hardworking, brilliant faculty, watch out, the University of Illinois will continue its great legacy of accomplishments. I was gratified that the governor in that last picture chose to visit Urbana as one of his first stops to promote his budget plan. It's clear that he has confidence in us and in our ability to deliver for Illinois. And we have bipartisan support in the state legislature. And I also say that we've got bipartisan support in the federal legislature for Illinois. So we have incredibly good alignment of decision makers with our university. And I think a growing recognition of the value of research intensive public higher education to a modern state that I always like to say is the size of the Netherlands and can certainly do more as we build out this economic development and educational platform. So now in the weeks ahead, of course, we're gonna work with the governor, and this is where we need your help, and the General Assembly to ensure that the plan to reinvest in public universities becomes a reality. And this is where, and I'd like to end here, this is where you have been so supportive of us, with an impact that is tangible, notable. We have been able together to rebuild trust in our university system, to deliver, to keep costs under control, to take on more responsibilities across the state for prosperity and social equity. And so we need you to continue to lend your voice in support of this historic budget turnaround, the proposed budget. And one way to do that, if you haven't already, and I know many of you have, is to become an Illinois Connection advocate. Believe me, those voices are powerful. They resonate in Springfield, and your real world experiences, your own personal stories really showcase how our universities open doors and impact lives. So thank you for the opportunity to talk about the exciting work happening across the system. And as I always like to say, you can probably tell from my comments that I'm an incurable optimist, and I admit to that. Pollyanna is probably my middle name, but we are moving, we're progressing, and we're the envy of many other institutions of public higher education, because we have our act together, we're moving forward in scale and impact, and we're doing it with the best principles of a strategic framework in mind, which is all about the public good. Thank you. Back to you, Jennifer.
Thank you, President Killeen, for that great update. We'll now open it up to Q&A. It looks like we have about a half an hour left in our webinar today. So we've already had several questions submitted, which is wonderful. Keep the questions coming in the Q&A portion. So one of the first questions, can you talk a little bit, President Killeen, on how we work with the other Illinois public universities?
Yeah, Jennifer, we work closely with the other public universities, and actually, with your personal leadership during the budget impasse period, you proposed and we initiated weekly calls with all of the chancellors and presidents that are continuing to this day. So every week on Wednesday, we have a Zoom call with the leadership of all the public universities in the state of Illinois. So everybody's got to know everybody else really well. During the pandemic, we were exchanging information. As I pointed out, you know, every one of those universities has used shield testing to keep open and to move forward. And so we're a collective, but obviously our system is these three great universities that I like to think of as just absolutely blindingly best in class. For their three quite different missions. But we work closely with the other public universities. We try to do that in a way that is not like the big gorilla coming in a threatening way but we work it collaboratively. The fact that we've now built this Illinois Innovation Network that includes regionally tailored innovation hubs at every one of the public universities shows how we've been able to design, manage, and lead a collective effort across the whole state, up and down the whole state, with all those universities participating. And I've been in other states where this kind of comity and collegiality is not present as quite as strongly, let me put it that way, as it is in Illinois. But we've got common challenges. Too many of our high schoolers who are college ready are leaving the state. It's roughly, you know, high 40%. So roughly half of the students leave the state. Often they do it for financial reasons. So that's where the state budget that you're all going to help us with is so incredibly important. We can't be outcompeted on cost by the state. Plus, you know, many of these public universities are in regions or in cities that need access to kind of a modern economic approach, often mediated by digital capabilities, but, you know, in advanced manufacturing in Rockford, in brewing technologies in Carbondale, tailored to the, so I'm very excited that we have this alignment where none of it would have happened without the University of Illinois system taking the lead. And we have as you've probably experienced, a common campaign, really. We're all singing from the same song sheet to really take this moment to reinvest in public higher education, because it's that important to the state. You know, a dollar from the state tax base returns 6.4% back to the state's tax base every year, independent of what the stock market does. It's the most reliable and effective investment that could be made, and we're all in it together. But I do point out, we don't like to be the big gorilla, but we are more than half of the undergraduate students, more than half of the student body in the whole state. So we are a very prominent, and we're the thought leader, and I think a generous collaborator as well with all those other universities.
Yeah, I would agree. We've had a couple of questions on the great resignation that's happening. And I don't know if you could talk about how higher education can help our states, keep people here, as well as educate them for what they might looking for next.
You know, it's the first thing that my head went to when you talk about the great resignation is we just lost three of our leaders who've gone to be presidents at other states, right? Okay, so they resigned, but it's a badge of courage and a badge of honor. We have a diaspora, right, of the University of Illinois We're going to be running the flagship universities with our former colleagues in Iowa, in South Carolina, and Wyoming. So watch out. But that was maybe a trivial response. I think there's a whole set of challenges coming out of the pandemic, and the way work is envisioned and occurs is changing. The role of hybrid systems. You know, some people have been dissatisfied with their role and are looking for improvements. We need to be, as a university system, we need to be moving with the times, opening doors of opportunity, creating the kinds of skills and competencies that will enable our graduates to be to move into civic society, perhaps stay in one job or company for the whole career, but more likely to be fluidly moving once in a while. But to job satisfaction is incredibly important. We, throughout this whole pandemic, have made, and we're a big employer in the state of Illinois, huge employer, 171,000 jobs that you can point to come out of the U of I system. We made a point of not laying anybody off. There were no furloughs. Unlike most other universities, frankly, where there were at the beginning of the pandemic when things shut down, we made a commitment to work with our own staff to recognize the importance that they of their roles that they brought. And I think I'm proud that our university system has kept to that. We have had no layoffs or furloughs. We even managed to get a sub-inflationary but significant increment in salaries right in the middle of the pandemic, right at the beginning of the pandemic, because it's that important. But I think the whole we need to be rethinking. We're going to be rethinking what the post-pandemic university should look like in fundamental ways. It won't be the same. We're not going to move away from our residential collegiate experience, snow fights on the quad kind of, you know, transformative experiences. But we're growing our distance educational products, 150 programs online. We're a powerhouse in distance education. Hybrid models have come of age. We're very good at it. As I pointed out, we're highly ranked in that. That same kind of thinking is going to work its way through other layers in society. And we need to make sure that our young people have the appropriate kinds of skills and competencies that will lead to satisfying jobs into the future. We're seen as a great place to work. I believe that we try to take care of our staff. We have seen some resignations, early retirements, and things like that. But we're forging ahead. And I think the deeper question is, we need to actually not just respond to, but we need to chart the path forward into this post-pandemic world with our brilliant faculty and our great, you know, minds, and that's what we're going to do.
So one follow-up question to that from someone was asking, how do you balance online and in-person education in this kind of hybrid post-pandemic world and still emphasize the importance of in-person, but also work on the strengths of the online?
Yeah, well, we've learned a lot through the pandemic. We knew a lot going in because we were, as I pointed out, very strong in distance education at the beginning. UIS is nationally renowned for its distance education product. But when we had to pivot early in the pandemic to totally online for a period of time, and that frankly was at our recommendation, because the state of Illinois would have been a little bit like New York City had the governor not taken our advice early on. But we pivoted quickly to fully online, and we were able to do that successfully. Now, not every student resonates with fully online, wants all the things to come through. Some prefer it to others. We think these hybrid modalities are going to be with us into the future, and they can be optimized. It's really important to make sure that the distance education products are not just putting your slides online, right, and just going through your talking points, but that they add value in lots of ways. So we have world experts on that kind of. So we're looking hard at how to optimize the learning experience for hybrid modalities. And so you'll find that there will be a mix of approaches. And like my coffee cup says, you know, we're going to focus this on the student experience. We want to optimize the student experience. Now, we know that it's been hard on young people in the last couple of years. Some have done well, some have less well. That's why I'm stressing mental health. But I think coming out of this, we're now in a leadership position nationally and internationally. You know, one thing I always like to point out is Illinois has more bandwidth than anywhere else on planet Earth. And bandwidth is power, right? So we can drive the whole hybrid family of modalities, which will enable us to expand our offerings, you know, beyond perhaps just the canonical four-year degree to, like we're talking about, K-12 computer skills, teaching the teachers, teaching the principals, opening up the pipelines there, and lifelong learning, upskilling, reskilling of the workforce is going to be done using these kind of hybrid modalities. So like everything else, we're going to be absolutely operating with excellence and learning as we go. We have three colleges of education and experts whose whole intellectual careers are bound up with this very question that was asked about how do you optimize? And I don't think there's a one size fits all answer to that. In fact, I know there isn't. It will be different for large introductory classes than for small graduate classes. It'll be different for K-12 curricular offerings and upskilling. We'll be looking at badges, credentials, stackable credentials, opportunities to return to a learning environment so that you can move forward in your life and career, as well as the master's, undergraduate degrees, baccalaureate degrees, et cetera. I can't, you know, we don't actually have the blueprint right now, but I can tell you we're working frantically on what that's going to look like for the U of I. And we're not going to move away from our commitment to the online residential experience because we just know how transformative that is. We're going to build on that in multiple ways. I hope that's a reasonable answer.
Yeah. And somewhat of a follow-up question is on SHIELD. So SHIELD is a remarkable example of research rapidly deployed to advance a profound public good in real time, a demonstration that the land grant mission is alive and relevant. Do you know what's next?
Well, SHIELD is kind of we had to write the book at some point because frankly, we were a little over our skis and we took some risks early on, but we were committed to making the campus safe. And the reason SHIELD came together, brilliant leadership by Chancellor Jones, Provost Kangalaris, but it was the generosity of our faculty to work across intellectual boundaries that really made it able to go as fast as it did. We were in a crisis mode, obviously. We had a large team of experts from different disciplines, chemistry, physics, mathematics, biology, veterinary medicine, working together to protect the campus community, right? That was the goal. And they did it with a culture of interdisciplinary collaboration. And that is our hallmark. The U of I's hallmark is generous interdisciplinary collaboration. It's not, it's mine, you can't have it. It's how do we work across boundaries? So I'm very proud of what we were able to pull off with SHIELD, but it's just the beginning. If you can imagine that ability now absent a crisis to work on other issues of importance, whether it's agricultural productivity or pourable concrete for bridges or the embedded sensors that let the built environment beam home to say, I need some help here in this bridge, or it's healthcare delivery so that we avoid healthcare deserts. I could go on and on and on and on. I think the platform we have for performance at the U of I is fantastic. And I take no credit for that. This is a pre-existing culture of generous, interdisciplinary collaboration. If you've got all of the experts and they're willing to kind of take on something, it's amazing what can happen. I don't think Google can do that. I don't think Amazon can do that. I don't think, companies can do that because they don't have the historians or the ethicists or the dance majors or you need all of these fields to be able to imagine and then deliver on a helpful future for society. That's going to flow out of these institutions, large, I would say, obviously voting with my feet, but large research intensive public universities where you've got all the fields and you have a commitment to excellence and integrity and disciplinary depth as well as interdisciplinary breadth. That's the recipe for many other things. So now the SHIELD program is looking at saliva testing for concussion, for oral cancer, for other types of viruses, common cold, flu, other kinds of viruses. So once you get a platform that is meaningful and you have commercialization pathways that we're now, SHIELD has become a viable business outside the state as well. So I think we need to build businesses. We need to have opportunities for startups with our students that are supported. But using this, the complex problems that society faces are going to require this confluence of expertise and the cultural willingness to work together. And I think the scale that we have and the placement, frankly, in a hardworking Midwest is just optimal for this. So I think you've seen the beginnings of what will be a new era of progress and contributions from the U of I system. And so that's why when I talk about hiring the next 900 faculty, we get it right, it's going to set this institution up for decades to come in very exciting ways, because these complex problems are not going away, whether it's crime in cities or healthcare delivery or curing cancer or global environmental stresses and strains. The world needs us.
Yeah, I agree. And it's exciting to watch. Can you also talk a little bit about the importance of social justice and what it means to our three campuses, our three universities in our system?
I think that's an incredibly important question. And it's something that we're working on directly. First of all, the thing to say is there's a commitment, and I like to call it, it's in the bone marrow of the University of Illinois for social justice. Jane Addams, beyond social work, all of the things we're doing in healthcare delivery. Our hospital, the only state hospital, has 46% of its patients are African-American, 26% are Latin. We're looking after people of color. Their healthcare we're looking after, and we're expanding that across the state. So we need to, and our whole innovation agenda, the DPIIN that I referred to, yes, it's about building prosperity and jobs, and we need to do that, but it's also about building social equity. In fact, what I like to say when I speak on this is if we don't give equal importance to the social equity component, we will have failed. It's not like we've partially succeeded. We would have failed, because if we're an engine of opening gaps between the haves and have-nots beyond where they are today, that's just not sustainable. We have to work to close those gaps. That's why we're working with K-12 kids to give them, an idea and they can imagine a future where there's a path forward that they can see themselves participating in many ways. So social justice, social equity has to be and is centrally important. And that again is a reason that public comprehensive institutions like this are important, because we have the experts, not just the will, but we have the experts, the deep experts on how to do this, what it means, how it should shape things in cities and in rural populations, etc. So And I like to think that the Midwest of the United States is a third of the GDP of the country. It's huge. I like, you know, the coasts are a little tapped out right now for various reasons. We have an opportunity to build an inclusive economic ecosystem that does not leave communities behind and out. And we need to show the world how to do that. It's not the same as Silicon Valley. It's not the same as Research Triangle Park. It's not the same as Kendall Square. It has to be an inclusive, innovative ecosystem that builds prosperity and, yes, creates wealth, but also builds social equity at the same time. So it's a question we think about all the time. Now, all that said, it's hard work, and we need to recommit and recommit and recommit. And so the voices that urge that on and can think about the modalities of doing that appropriately in inner cities, in rural regions, in, you know, peri-urban towns that used to have a manufacturing core that's dissipated, for many, many reasons, for social cohesiveness, we need to be absolutely on the positive side of that coin.
Thank you. Another question, can you give an example of things that are asked of Illinois Connection members or what that means to be an Illinois Connection?
The main thing I would say is, for whatever reason, public trust and confidence in higher ed eroded for some decades. And it was connected to, I think, cost concerns and considerations and, you know, a perspective that, so anyway, we've turned that corner at the U of I system. We have public trust and confidence, and SHIELD, frankly, has been enormously important. Who could deny that's, you know, saved lives, tens and tens of thousands of lives. And it's also another thing I'm very proud of, if I can squeeze in, is we pioneered the test to stay program in schools, so that if a kid in a K-12 setting is exposed and they get SHIELD tested every other day, they can stay in the scholastic setting. They don't have to go home disrupting the whole family enterprise. And so test to stay, we pioneered here in Illinois, and it was taken up then by the CDC. So so what can Illinois Connection do? I think we need to sort of project the value proposition of public higher education writ large as too important to be ignored or put on a low priority. Just too important. It's not a cost center, it's a profit center. It returns direct economic benefit to society. And we've got all of these voting alumni, so watch out, don't mess with us, kind of those kind. So I'm joking a little bit, but messaging out that this is a time to invest as a state, and kind of in a demanding tone, in a collegial, friendly, but demanding tone. But for too long, it's been seen as too low a priority, and you don't create a prosperous, inclusive, modern state without public education. And we're operating, as we've demonstrated, I think, on all cylinders now. So that message needs to get into the decision makers' minds. And we have 450,000 living alums. We need them to support their institution. But the onus is on us too, and me and us in the management and administration of the university, to do things like this to be held accountable as well. So it's a partnership. We need you in Illinois Connection to advocate strongly for this. And obviously I'm an educator, so this is, for me, it's been my life's mission, but it is important for the health, prosperity, wealth, human welfare, social equity, social cohesion of the state to really invest in particularly in the University of Illinois system. I do have a competitive bone in my body or two, and don't get me started on certain universities. We are showing the world a clean pair of heels right now. Let's take advantage of that and invest. So that's a simple message. Hold us accountable, but let's get with the program here. Yeah, it's been too many decades of disinvestment. It's time to really take this state. The capital of the Midwest is Chicago. It's not Detroit. It's Chicago. We can lift the whole region up and do it with more bandwidth than anyone else on the planet. Expertise that's undeniably great in health and environment and cities and built environment, all kinds of things. So the message is a positive one. Let's lift people's spirits, and we've talked it down too much over too many years.
Yeah, I agree. I know we're coming to the end of our time, and there are a lot of questions that we weren't able to get to, but we will be following up individually with everyone. I have a good one though to end on. What advice would you give future leaders, future learners and leaders?
Future learners and leaders. Well, first of all, everybody should be a learner, right? Leaders should be learners. So we should all be open to learning, listening, digesting, discerning, reading, understanding, seekers of truth, right? It's all important that, and the world is changing fast. So advice to learners that I like to give our own kids, you know, is just day at a time, make progress. Take some time to be healthy, to take care of yourself, your family, to not get consumed by something that gets you upset or riled up, but to have an open mind, to listen to different points of view that are really important, to understand why people may completely disagree, but without being disagreeable. I think it's important to just progress. Young people can get discouraged. When I go into a classroom, sometimes I'll ask, raise your hand if you've ever felt alienated or isolated. And every time I do that, hands go up. So we've got to look after one another too. We've got to act like a community takes care of itself. So mental health is for everybody to worry about. For leaders, I grew up in Wales where, you know, there's not a lot of ego taught in Wales because you have the English on the other side of the Upper Dyke. And anyway, I could go on like that. But I think the most important thing for me is servant leadership. It's not about fame, fortune, or even rankings or ratings. It should be about contributions and authentic commitment to progress. And if you do it that way, I try to do it that way. And, you know, I'm working with great colleagues who do it that way too. The credit flows, it just flows naturally. People know instantly if somebody's in it for some, you know, ulterior motive, or it's just all about them kind of thing. What I often think is if you're consumed by credit and you get credit for doing something like X, you're really striving to do X for the credit, and you've got X and you've got some credit. Now you're on Y, then you're on Z. So there's never enough to go around. So I distill that in the term servant leadership. I respect leadership that clearly has a servant perspective, and it's not self-aggrandizing. So that would be my humble suggestion for leadership.
Well, thank you. And as the land-grant flagship university, I think that that's all part of our mission as well, to be servant leadership to the state. And thank you for everyone who joined us this morning. I think it was a great conversation. And again, I'm sorry if we did not get to your questions, but we will be following up with each and every one of you. And like President Killeen said, we need you, we need your voice, and we appreciate all that you do for the university. So thank you, and everyone have a great weekend. Thank you. Bye-bye.